Interesting. You know what? I noticed I played something like this. And I'm playing it legato. And the sound is articulate, isn't it? Yeah, exactly.
They did a little bit more attack than they would do on a good acoustic. Mm. So
what about the wind pressures? Do we know anything about the wind pressures?
They are
120.
Yeah. The higher ones.
And he doesn't get more sound out of it.
There in the organ you hear basically exactly the same as you hear here.
Okay.
This is particularly important, of course, in a hall that is rather dead.
Right, yeah.
That you need to rely on the legato completely. Mm. Because otherwise you cannot give an acoustical image.
Yeah.
Oh,
it is.
Yes. Yeah, it is. Okay. It is. It is ambient.
Of the proportional action. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. If you have the same effect there. Mm-hmm.
Do you have time for that?
I think we see it all.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's go.
Après, moi, je cherche.
C'est plus facile à moi.
Oui, c'est vrai.
Positif, aussi celui, mais on entend bien là-bas.
Oui, et donc on va peut-être essayer le même jeu.
Je vais passer.
I think it sounds more legato. It feels more legato, there's no question.
But Hans has an interesting point there.
So when there is no noise kind of a character in the sustained sound, no sizzling or what you hear in the Monte by Cavai Collins, then you hear much more of the speech. The cleaner the sustained sound, the more we hear the speech.
Fascinerande och fantastiskt projekt att Göteborgs konserthus ska få en ny konserthusorgel av världsklass. Och det började 2016 med en fråga till den internationella orgelakademin och till mig som konstnärlig ledare. Skulle ni kunna hjälpa oss att få liv i den gamla orgeln? Och under ett halvår så tog vi kontakt med internationell spetskompetens, organister, orgelsakkunniga, experter, men också sex internationella orgelbyggare som har erfarenhet av att restaurera och att bygga nya konserthusorgel. Och resultatet utav denna förstudie, alla var på plats, så var att man konstaterat att den orgeln som finns, den går att restaurera, men om man gör det så kommer man att få ett instrument som låter som på 1930-talet för de förhållandena. Alltså en orgel som inte kommer att kunna motsvara det krav man ställer på en konserthusorgel idag. Så därför var vår rekommendation att bygg en ny konserthusorgel, demontera försiktigt, ta hand om det kulturhistoriskt värdefulla instrumentet från 1937 byggt av Markussen och Sønn i Danmark. Det har ett stort värde i sig, men det kommer aldrig kunna fungera som konserthusorgel. Ta hand om den orgeln, försök finna en annan plats för den. Sen sa vi, för att kunna göra en konserthusorgel i världsklass och med tanke på Göteborgs status som internationellt känd orgelstad, symfonikernas kvaliteter som nationalorkester, internationellt verksam symfoniorkester på högsta nivå, så måste vi spänna bågen högt. Och det kan man inte göra när det gäller att skapa ett instrument som ska vara bättre än det som har gjorts hittills, om man inte kopplar in den modell som Göteborg står för, nämligen referensgruppen, en kollektiv spetskompetens som då understödjer den firma som ska bygga instrumentet, som naturligtvis måste väljas ut så att man får de allra mest lämpade orgelbyggarna, de skickligaste som finns i vår tid med den största erfarenheten till att göra det här projektet. Och i vårt urval var referensgruppen helt överens om att det var Rieger Orgelbau i Schwarzach i Österrike som hade det i särklass bästa förslaget. En ny konserthusorgel präglad av den franska symfoniska traditionen, men med många nya inslag och ny teknik som gör det möjligt att använda instrumentet på innovativa sätt, ovanliga vis, och också skapa klanger utav det slag som man ännu inte har hört. Alltså tradition och innovation i en fantastiskt fin kombination.
Den insikten från vår sida om att vi faktiskt ägde instrumentet, det var en viktig händelse. Den andra viktiga händelsen, det var nog när vi gjorde förstudien där vi gav Göteborgs Aural Akademi ett uppdrag att göra en belysning på hur kan man använda den orgeln som finns eller vad behöver vi göra för att få den att fungera och vad finns det för alternativ. Och den tredje och kanske viktigaste eftersom det är den orgeln som ska in, det var när vi efter förstudien gjorde en upphandling, vi var ute och frågade världens största orgeltillverkare och där vi slutligen då med Aural Akademins hjälp kunde finna att det var Rieger i Österrike som hade det mest lämpliga instrumentet att sätta in. Det ska jag vilja säga att det är de tre viktigaste sakerna i, utifrån mitt perspektiv i orgelprojektet.
Referensgruppen som ska stödja måste naturligtvis för att kunna göra det träffa orgelbyggarna regelbundet. Och den process som Higab som då beställt den nya orgeln och står för detta i nära samarbete med symfonikerna tog till sig, det var det här att referensgruppen då möts två gånger om året och att vi samverkar med orgelbyggaren för att få fram det bästa tänkbara konstnärliga resultat. Och i mars hade vi den första referensgruppen, spelade på och lyssnade till nya orglar utav Rieger, dels i La Philharmonie, stor ny konsertsal i Paris, och sen i Kassel, ett nydanande musik mer ämnat för modern musik som Rieger byggde sommaren 2017. Sommaren 2018 så var Rieger på plats i Göteborg med ett team av fyra medarbetare som under fyra veckor demonterade den befintliga orgeln. Alla pipor, hela luftsystemet och de 27 väderlådorna, allt transporterades steg för steg med hand och fot lastbil till Kviberg där det nu är lagrat. Med förhoppningen att vi ska kunna finna en ny plats där denna kulturhistoriskt värdefulla orgel ska kunna klinga ut. Ska kunna framstå i all sin nyansrikedom utifrån sin fulla potential. Och projektet har under året vidareutvecklats både i detalj och i koncept genom Skype-möten med referensgruppen och då ett referensgruppsmöte i Göteborg i samband med Göteborgs orgelfestival i oktober månad då vi samlades under två dagar, gjorde tester i konsertsalen, lyssnade på enskilda piper för att empiriskt också ställa samman vad vi visste från akustikundersökningar och känna att vi är på rätt väg och tänker rätt när det gäller inställningen, om man säger volyminställningen eller orgelbyggaren säger mensurer, mått på piper, hur man lägger upp det hela. Och att diskutera detaljer, koncept tillsammans med Rieger Orgelbau. Och vi känner att vi har ett koncept, ett instrument, en konserthusorgel som vi säger i världsklass som kommer att kunna jämföras med den stora orgeln i La Philharmonie i Paris. Den är utav samma storlek och till och med i vissa avseenden mer intressant, lite nydanande. Och där säger vi inom referensgruppen att vi har en känsla utav att vi får vara med om ett projekt för göteborgarna, för alla orgelintresserade här som ska kunna göra det möjligt att få en konserthusorgel som kan ge inspiration och nyansats för de närmaste 30-40 åren utav orgelbyggeri i konserthus sammanhang.
Så välkommen till Göteborgs konserthus och den vackra konsertsalen. Nils Einar Eriksson var ju arkitekt och designade detta musikens hus. 1935 öppnades, invigdes det. Och man upplever ju den här salen med sina släta väggar, sin välda form så här som ett musikens tempel. Och som vi har berättat så är det ett stort, viktigt, spännande projekt på gång. En ny konserthusorgel i världsklass är på väg att byggas, installeras. Och sedan förra året så har vi arbetat tillsammans med Rieger Orgelbau i Österrike som bygger instrumentet i referensgruppen, den internationella referensgruppen, med design, tester, utförande. Och vi var nere i Österrike i januari för att se verkstaden, mycket imponerande, och testa olika saker, mekanik och olika överföringar och grejer som är ny teknikutveckling i projektet, och besluta de sista, så att säga, detaljerna. Konceptet har ju legat klart, men det är ju alltid ett utförande och in i de små delarna.
It's a very traditional, very old company. It was founded in 1845 in Jägendorf, which was part of the Austrian Empire at that time. Things have changed. Meanwhile, the Rieger family was followed by the family Glattergötz, but the name was kept. So it was three generations the Rieger family, three generations the Glattergötz family, and now it's the seventh generation with my family Eberle. We aim to produce everything here in our workshop. We are doing all the woodwork, all the artistic work, all the technical things. We have our own pipe making shop, we have our own electronic department, we have a voicing team with four voicers. So everything is under one roof. We don't buy things, we don't put the name on things we haven't done ourselves. So we make the instruments, we design the instruments, we build it up, we voice it, and then it's a real Rieger organ. We have our own, we call it music school. All the apprentices have to learn how to play the organ during their apprentice time, which is almost 4 years. So every week they get a lesson, and the company is responsible for it and will pay or is paying for it. And we have hired a professional organ player and a musician who is teaching our youngsters. I think it's important that they just know a little bit about music, and that they know about the instrument itself and how an instrument like an organ behave. I think that's part of the thing they have to know.
Would you care to say something about what it's like to work with the Gothenburg Symphony Project Group?
As I learned over the last 2 years, it's very easy to work with them, and it's, on one hand, it's a challenge, yes, because it's so much knowledge combined in this group, and with our experience, to bring all this together is kind of a challenge on the one hand, but on the other hand, it's a big chance to improve our own knowledge and to learn about things and create something interesting, something new. Right now the challenge is to make final decisions. We are at the point where we have to start really with detailed planning, and soon we will start building the instrument. So it's the point now, after a long period of discussion and collecting ideas, we are at the point now where we have to make real decisions, and from that point onwards, there's no way back. So that's the challenge now. Soon we start producing parts in our workshop. And then during the summer period, during summer holidays, we will start installing part of the organ, the back part of the organ. Yeah. My personal expectation is to have an instrument where we feel we did the right thing. And hopefully then it will match what the client was expecting and what the group of experts was expecting. But I think we are on a very good way.
What do you enjoy the most with building organs?
Meeting many, many different and interesting people all over the world. So that's the, for me personally, that's a very interesting thing. And see many different countries and cultures. So that's, and finally, of course, the art itself, hearing the product we've built.
And what you see here is a clarinet. It's a free reed stop, and I'm working on the last pipes here. So then it gets a tuning rod. I can lengthen or shorten the reed, and that means it the vibration is faster or slower, and sits on the boot and goes in the wind chest. Well, I started as an organ builder because I was very fascinated by the whole variety of this work. You know, there are so many different aspects in organ building. I mean, it's not just woodwork, it's working with metal, it's with all kinds of materials, the musical part also. And later on I became or got into the field of voicing, and I'm always fascinated by the work of creating sound, you know. And I mean, this is I just love that work, because you can create something beautiful and nice, and that is what keeps me motivated.
Och under några veckor nu så har Riegers, så att säga, besättning här i Göteborg, fyra energiska, duktiga orgelbyggare, installerat hela den bakre delen av orgeln. Så det är alla verk som har svällare, som vi säger, som kan öppnas, stängas, dynamiska verk. Den delen av orgelhuset och fläktarna, bälgarna bakom, har installerats. Arbetet avslutas denna veckan, och sen vilar projektet fram till oktober, då referensgruppen träffas här för att göra första lyssningstesterna. Tre stycken stämmer, se hur det utvecklar sig med klangbalans och utstrålning från svällverken. Och sen har vi en avstämning under våren, och sen byggs naturligtvis under detta år hela orgeln klar. Och i juni nästa sommar kommer allt att börja installeras. Om man tänker sig en hockeymatch, så är vi nu liksom i första pausen mellan första och andra halvlek. Nästa sommar så kommer andra halvlek, installation av hela orgeln. Och sen kommer tredje halvlek sommaren därefter då, intonation och färdigställande utav den nya konserthusorgeln i Göteborgs konserthus. Fantastiskt spännande att sitta här nu. Mm. Tre år.
Ja, tre år har det gått.
Ja. Sen vi sågs första gången det här med ny konserthusorgel för Göteborgs konserthus.
Ja. Så det var väldigt goda nyheter att Higab tog initiativ till det i goda samtal med oss här på konserthuset. Och det var ju hösten 16 som Stefan Lundqvist, som det var tillförordnad vd, tog beslut att nu går vi vidare. Mm. Och vi siktar mot jubileet 2021, Göteborgs stadsjubileet. Och det var ett glädjande nyhet för oss, och det var ju då vi tog kontakt med dig också, som var självskriven och har med som spindeln i nätet. Och sen så har det gått snabbt, och här sitter vi idag, och nu har vi då pratat om öppningsveckan, kan man väl säga. Så det är väldigt, väldigt kul, och då ska vi såklart ha öppningskonserter, vi ska ha seminarier, vi ska berätta om hela resan. Och så ska vi försöka etablera någonting nytt i stan, i Västra Götalandsregionen, för vi har alltså ett nytt instrument i stan som kommer att bli helt fantastiskt, men också kommer att betyda någonting för den publik som ska komma hit på konserter och lyssna, och kanske också för orgelmiljön i stan.
Absolut, jag menar, Göteborg som internationellt känd orgelstad får ju ett fantastiskt tillskott med den nya konserthusorgeln som vi gläder oss enormt över. Mm. Möjligheter
Visst.
Att bjuda in till orgelns liksom sinnliga, passionerade nya klangvärldar i ett symfoniskt format, i kombinationer sånt som vi inte fått uppleva tidigare.
Så vi ska få något fint där i öppningsveckan på, det blir oktober då.
Precis, då så. Får vi då blir fokus i vår internationella orgelfestival naturligtvis detta nya flaggskepp instrument som vi får här i alla dess möjliga kombinationer.
Ja, eller hur?
Och en konserthusorgel i världsklass för alla.
Ja, eller hur? Ja, det ska vara demokratiskt, och vi ska öppna dörrarna här. Ett av de projekten som vi har pratat om är att alla organister i
regions 49 kommuner ska få lov att göra en liten konsert här under den vecka, öppningsveckan. Det inkluderar alla på något sätt. Så alla, kan man komma från Gullspång eller Åmål och så lyssna på sin organist i Göteborgs konsert. Det blir spännande.
Det blir riktigt spännande.
What's happening right now?
Right now we are seeing that the first delivery of parts for the summer of the new concert hall organ and the podium wall and canopy is arriving. So we see some things coming up through the elevator and the truck is down at the street getting unloaded right now. Mm-hmm. So that's the morning activity. And we can also see that some equipment that Rieger brought to establish that little workshop back behind the organ room that we see here now. Also, so it's kind of the very beginning of an intensive summer phase of lots of work.
Mm. So this canopy is now in a yellow color. What's happening?
The iron frame that we see of the canopy is original. Yeah, was there in 1935 when the building was inaugurated. And that's protected and kept, so it's been there, but has had different shapes of wood framing panels and things. It was closed at the beginning, and then it was opened up, I believe, already in the 1980s, and then changed again in the early 2000s. And now we have taken all these parts down, and all the electrical installations, lights, and stuff like that. So now the canopy will get a new architecture, new shape, and it's going to combine the need to have it as open as possible for the sound to be projected or diffused into the hall from the organ, and to give sufficient reflection to the orchestra on the podium, and then to give a visual sense of that it's not closed but kind of more like one surface, like the walls and the ceiling of the concert hall, so that it better suits the architecture of Nils Einar Eriksson.
Mm. So Nils Einar, tell me about him.
He was one of the most important architects, not only in Göteborg in the 1930s, and he was particularly interested in music and acoustics. So I've heard and read about his meetings with musicians, curious about the acoustics and stuff, and curious to know which halls and which acoustics they preferred to play in. Mm. So many years he gathered information, impressions and through such contacts, and then he won a competition here, and he designed the space so that it would match the new ideas and findings in architecture and acoustics, particularly in France and in Paris, where he had lots of contacts. Mm. So the surface here is of wood, and it's sycamore maple, and then the panels are mounted to the walls with wooden frames, and also they have a little bit of wooden pieces, we could say, attached on the back to affect their ability to resonate. So it's like a kind of tuning, you know, of the wood. That was the idea, that they should be light and resonant, but yet they should not be too, I suppose, too easy to drive in terms of resonance and vibrations. So it's a very thoughtful construction where we are extremely careful not to change any of these things. Mm-hmm. So we're going to now with the both the canopy, that's more architecture, you know, but then we're going to have new, we call them swell shutters or standing panels. that when they are closed will make the whole wall clean and nice looking, like it was from the beginning with larger panels. Mm. But then you can, as a musician, also open them and let, when the organ plays, of course, they basically need to be open to let the sound out.
Mm. So coming back to this tuning of the wood, that's a fascinating concept, mm-hmm. how to tune a piece of wood. Mm. Would you care to tell us about that?
Well, you know, when we talk about when instrument builders today and people involved in research about musical instruments talking about tuning of the wood, we see that builders in the past were much more aware of how the acoustical behavior of an instrument with all its parts, not only the soundboard, for example, of a keyboard instrument, but even the soundboard is not just one thickness, you know, that you can see thickness variation, which is a trace of how you tuned the most important part for the sound of a keyboard instrument, for example. But then also in keys and in other surfaces, you can see that there seem to, there is clearly an awareness of how they play a role in the overall function of the instrument. Mm. And that's a kind of awareness which is in modern times, in our time, I think basically lost. Mm. And we have to rediscover and learn from artifacts. Mm. And it's very interesting to see that there was such, that Nils Einar Eriksson was really striving at tuning the whole, and had a sense of that is really important, how the panels are attached and how wooden pieces are mounted on the backside of them. And when we are going to take down the panels of the podium wall, because we need to do that in the center at least, to have the mechanical connection from the fixed console of the organist, which is going to be down in the middle, and which is going to be on a lift so that you can move it down so it is not even seen, and then you can raise it. It's mechanically connected, and it's the first console in that we know of that has been mechanical console that has been built in such a way that you can raise it and lower it.
We've just finished the baldachin. That was last night. We did the last part of the baldachin. So we drank a beer after that.
I imagine.
And end of this week, we will also finish the general swell shutters. Mm-hmm. Yeah, at least the upper two rows. We keep the lower row open to bring some bigger parts, bigger pipes into the organ later on. Mm-hmm. And parallel to that, we are working on the inside. We are have already finished the winding system. We're working on the electronics, so parallel on different parts of the organ.
So how large is your crew at Gothenburg Concert Hall right now?
It's huge. We are 11 people now here. So that's very rare. Usually we do an installation with 4 or 5, maximum 6 people, but the time is very short here. We are limited. We lost a little bit time of the corona crisis that had an influence, but we worked hard to come here and to continue with the work. Otherwise it would have been postponed for a year, and we really worked hard to avoid that. So we are slightly behind schedule, but we are on track still.
It's a question of weeks rather than months, right?
No, it's a question of days, yes.
Okay, yeah. So mm-hmm. It's not really a delay then.
No, it's not a big delay, but no. Still, yeah, we have only this small window during the summertime. And so we wanted to start, or we really keep going to start with the voicing on the 4th of August. So that's why we are a little bit under pressure now with the technical work.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So tell me, we're in the foyer here, and behind your back there are some panels, or actually swell shutters, right?
Yeah, those are the swell shutters, the lower row of the swell shutters, which is not installed yet. Yeah, we did all the varnishing of it 2 weeks ago. It still is drying. It takes quite a long time because it's oil on, based on oil varnish. So it takes weeks to really get hard to dry to dry out. So
let's go closer and see the texture. What were the major challenges for you?
The major challenges was to find a type of wood which is very similar to the one which was used 90 years ago. We knew it's sycamore maple, so it's growing in our area, but it's still very hard to find this very special texture which fits with the rest of the panels, which are, as I said, already 90 years old, so that was a big challenge.
How is it done even? I mean, how can you find the right color and the right nuance of the varnish?
The color was done here on site. The people, the specialists came here, three of them, and we made some samples, and then we decided together with the antiquarians which color we use. So we did a few samples, we adjusted it slightly, we waited overnight, saw it again next day, and then we finally said, okay, that's the color, that's what we do. And then it went on.
And if you look at this wood close up, you can see there are enormous differences in texture and nuancing in the wood in itself, because this is striped and this is non-striped. As
yeah,
you can see
that's here. Exactly what's what was done 90 years ago, what's in the hall. So they used at least three different types of wood, and we tried to adjust as good as possible to the existing parts, to the texture of the old parts.
And this is such a beautiful area to dry the wood to.
That was very good. So the environment for us was optimal here.
Perfect.
It's perfect space for work. We had lots of space for laying everything out and keep it without any dust for the drying period, so that's very important.
Good. And you've covered some of the interior here, of course.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. That's important.
Yeah.
And the first glance is the finished, the new baldachin. And coming week, they will start with the installation of the lighting system, and then that will complete the visual part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So probably end of next week or within the next 2 weeks, we will see it really finished.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we can also see that the middle part of the back wall is changed a bit. It's where the console is going to be, the mechanical console.
Yeah, we decided when we came here this time, we decided to remove all the panelings on the lower part just to make it perfect again.
Mm-hmm.
And what we found out is it's a concrete wall, black painted. So we thought in the middle part where the panels can be taken off later on, we color it in the same color as used on the other parts of the interior.
Yeah.
So that's why we changed it.
Yeah.
That's the area where all the trackers will run from the console to the winches. The console will arrive next Tuesday, and then we'll bring it into place. And but it will take several weeks to do all the install all the trackers and so on. So we just started today with the repaneling. These are the existing panels, which have been on that particular place, and we add some panels which were in storage for over 20 years now.
Yeah.
We took them out, they are on this side here, and they will complete the lower part below the new swell shutters.
Mm-hmm.
So this will be a mixture of old, very old, and new. We do it exactly the same way as it was,
So we put some cloth on the framework. That's exactly what was done 90 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
That's because of to avoid any vibration of the paneling
mm-hmm.
from the lower frequencies mm-hmm. of the orchestra mm-hmm. part.
Mm-hmm.
And then it will be fixed in a way that you don't see any screws or anything.
Nice, mm-hmm. nice. And what we can see here is that you have done a few slight changes here. Because you had to cut those
beams.
Yeah,
we had to cut the beam, the main beam, because we need the space to run the trackers here. We are limited to a depth of 12 centimeters now for
all of the
manual
trackers.
Keyboards and the tracker for the
amazing
pedal.
That's the challenge.
Five lines running from here into the organ.
Yeah. And so tell us, you're talking about lines. So it's not a traditional tracker system you're building up, of course.
It's like it's a part of it is traditional. The part inside the organ is traditional. The part here is done by very special ropes, because we have to move the console up and down. So we need a flexible material, flexible and. On one side, on the other hand, it has to be very stiff and strong, same as a mechanic tracker wood.
Yeah.
So part of it will be in wood, traditional way, and here this part will be very special with. So we're entering the inside of the organ now.
Mm-hmm.
What we see here is quite a bit of technique. Winding system, the bellows are installed already. The wind trunks, the channels, swell boxes. This is something we invented. It's a combination system. You can play the organ either mechanically or electric. If you play with the electric console, you still play it proportional. Like a mechanic organ.
Uh-huh.
It's not just an on-off system, it's a proportional system. And that's something quite new. That means we need two different systems running parallel.
Mm-hmm.
The electric part, the proportional part, and the mechanic part. And it's even possible to play both together without
uh-huh.
influencing each
uh-huh.
other.
Interesting.
Mm. Hmm.
And that's what we see here. That's the beginning of it.
Ah.
So we see the general swell now. One row is in already from the inside. And the metal framework is covered already, the original one.
Yeah.
So looks quite finished.
Yeah.
So far.
And the top part is going to be fixed wall, or is it?
No.
It's
also
supposed to be. Ah,
yeah,
okay.
Just continue
separate.
Now there. It's a separate row.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We have three separate independent rows. It's the one down here and the two upper ones.
Ah.
They are above the baldachin.
Mm-hmm.
This is below the baldachin.
Yeah. So there's going to be a huge possibility to work dynamically then, of course, with the sounds.
That's what we at least hope, yes, that the dynamic will be enormous, the dynamic range of the frequencies, yes.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Because you have swell boxes here,
and on the other
here,
side,
course,
there are three swell divisions, the orchestral in the center part of it, the positive on the left, and the reci on the right.
Uh-huh.
And on top, there are the biggest pipes, the 32-foot Untersatz,
mm-hmm.
Bol Bourdon, and Supas.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Exciting. So next step then will be installing the mechanical console next week.
It will arrive next week.
Yeah.
We'll start. We will continue here in the organ and work from inside the organ down to the console. That's the way.
Mm-hmm.
So on the top here to the middle of the organ, we have the treble of the positive, and on the lower floor here we have the soundboard for the bass units of the positive stops.
Complex, many
complex
arms, many
little bit.
Rollers.
Yes.
And they have to run without friction. Also,
yes.
Right? Yeah.
Of course, you need some friction.
Yeah.
Otherwise,
yeah.
you will have like a little knock every time it moves. Mm. But it shouldn't be too much
no.
and not too less at the same
no.
time.
Yeah.
And in the end of the day, it should work properly.
Yeah.
So yes.
It's an exciting challenge.
Yeah,
it
takes time.
Yeah.
But yeah, the more thoroughly you do it, the better it will work, and the longer it will stay this way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is the huge space for the orchestra division. So we were talking about enough height for the bass pipes. Here the whole division is in the center with lots of height. The Ressi and the positive have divided spaces for treble and bass. So just a little view on the organ before the reference group meeting, so we can see everything that's been done this summer. So we see the podium wall here with the general swell shutters, and the panels have been rearranged, so we now have more historical material in the wall, actually an extra half meter. And then we see the console down here, which has also sycamore maple, a very special example of wood that they chose, and then lighter. The stop knobs are not yet here, as you can see. So we have the manuals shaped like some Trinity, very, very nice space and natural shape in here. And then we have the upper ranging of the maneuver here, tabs, and then they have not yet brought the stop knobs. So we have this intermediary stop panel here, and this is because they are working on the proportional stop action to figure out exactly how it works technically. So that's why they didn't bring it. So this is it here, and we can go up and look at the interior of the instrument. So the 2+2 voicers have come, Stefan, but also Alois, and assisted by Martin, who is the team leader here, and Daniel, who is the second assistant. We come in and we see the big central electric cabinet with all stuff just at the entrance of the organ. You can see all the action from the Ressi treble coming down here, and of course the positive, the action from the positive treble discount coming down on the other side. And here we have no stops, and we don't plan now until next week or this session to have anything installed really here. And then we have here the bellows for the grate. The high pressure and the grate blowers are in the big box at the back there. So as we know, the design is such that we have quite a lot of space behind the back wall of Ressi here and the organ. So the two big blowers are in this big box here with doors on the sides. And then we have the primary, the first bellows, one on each side, that delivers the wind to the secondary bellows underneath. So when we look down, we can see one pipe of the Montre lying there, and under it, under the walkboard, is the two big bellows. And here we see the Subas 32. And here is the trunk that goes for the ventilation.
well, let's say, air circulation system between the top and the bottom of the organ. And when we turn around here, you see the mitered Bombard 32, the upper part of the bass octave. Here we see the two chests for the Grand Orgue, and as you can see, the positioning of the pipes is tiers aufstellung. So, and the Bourdon 16 has been elevated, and the bass octave is placed up here, not to block the sound, to allow for sound development of best kind as well. So you can see here from the inside the general swell, and everything is nicely made, really fitting very well, and they built in the raw concrete and iron structure, so it looks like like the interior of a very very nice house, you know, somehow your own living room somehow. So I think this probably gives you a good impression. Yeah, we can see from here also when we look up the Subas 32, and on the sides we can see the upper parts of the Bombard 32 coming up as well. And Alois working with a flute.
Flute.
Yeah, flute avonik. So. Så ska vi då gå till den där sjätte delen, där vi har baspiper, en orgel under parkettgolvet i konsertsalen. För att komma in i sjätte delen av orgeln så får vi gå genom Götaplatsfoajén och in, liksom ett bakhåll in mot parkettgolvet under konsertsalen. Här brukar inte någon komma in, så det är lite trångt. Här har vi en ny dörr och ett nytt hål in i har vi 40 pipor. De största i trä, som liksom har en systerpipa då, de stämmorna här under golvet. 20 stycken i två stämmor. Subbas 32 och då flut 16 öppen. Och de ligger här, så 20 stycken ser vi riktade mot oss med en fläkt längst bort. Så det finns en egen luftförsel här. Och sen ligger de andra 20 piporna åt andra hållet. Så det innebär att hela, ja, en tredjedel drygt utav hela parkett har den här basorgeln under fötterna. Man känner och man hör de låga frekvenserna tack vare denna first ever i konserthussammanhang och överhuvudtaget i orgelvärlden då byggda basorgeln. Tack vare att det är hål under varje stol så går ju klangen upp. Det är som en lite som en schweizerost och en resonansbotten på en gång. Så det är härligt att kunna känna och höra de låga frekvenserna. Thank you.
your subwoofer?
You got the money worth.
Maybe it's when I go up the stairs.
Yeah, you know, it's like...
da, 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 da. Thinking the contrabass has this kind of lumpy effect. Which is more desirable.
Sort of amazed because I've been following the story of this instrument now for a couple of years, and to see it happen so beautifully and really so quickly is sort of a miracle. To see it built into a room that where it fits, a room that is very unusual, where the organ needs to fit in to the history of this room and not dominate it, not overtake it. Both visually or orally, you know, one must feel that the organ belongs in the room when you look and when you hear. So this is what I've seen in these just for these 2 days, to really experience the instrument, both listening to someone else play and playing myself, to be able to see that this organ really fits in this room so beautifully. And it fills the room, but it doesn't overpower the room. You never feel like you've got, when it's loud, that you have to get away from this sound after 5 seconds. And there are many organs in spaces such as concert halls, as opposed to cathedrals, where the sound is, it's almost as if you can't escape it sometimes, and you can't listen to a whole piece that's really loud. But here, this works. you can hear the sound and you can listen to it for quite some time at its full volume. And it's full, and it covers a spectrum of harmonics in the sound, rather than just sort of one, like a truck coming at you, driving at full speed. Instead, it's this multifaceted sound that comes to you and that you can connect with and embrace rather than be hit by. So this is really good. And you even feel it in the seats. When you're sitting, you feel the vibrations in the entire room. So you feel like you're sitting inside an instrument. This instrument has aspects of many historical styles of organs. Probably the dominant sound might sing with a somewhat French accent, a French 19th century, 20th century accent. However, there are these elements of the very subtle elements of German Romanticism in this instrument, in the orchestral division. So it can almost switch, and by avoiding certain stops and highlighting others, you can make the organ sing with a very German accent of the 19th century especially. So this is a wonderful thing. This is difficult to achieve in an organ, and many organs cannot do this. They are sort of, as the old saying goes, everything in the world is either French or German. And usually organs follow that as well. And so this organ is actually doing both, maybe not simultaneously, but in the same instrument. But each one with its own distinct character. Sometimes when we have organs that try to be too many things at once, they start to lose character, and the sound is very bland, and they sort of do nothing well. But this organ does many things quite convincingly. One thing we see in Rochester, I've noticed now after a concert, I'll overhear someone say, "Oh, I'd rather hear the Buxtehude piece on such and such an organ rather than that organ." And then I'm very happy because I realize these are becoming people who have discerning taste, almost like they prefer this wine over that wine. They prefer to hear this music on this organ and this music on this organ. So I think this is a very good thing for developing an audience, you know, that people really care and invest in listening differently to different instruments.